For the next 12 months, in a scale from 1 to 10, I think the world economy is going to be between a 6 or a 7.
North America and Europe will continue to stagnate a bit, and the emerging markets, particularly the BRICS, will probably take a bit of a dive.
I believe for the near future, energy security is going to be a big risk.
When the countries, especially the strong ones, are protecting themselves for their own interests, the whole world is suffering.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for staying for this final plenary. I'm delighted to have been asked to moderate this. It is such a big topic, mind you. The issue of whether or not we'll have a Brexit back home in Britain is also an enormous topic in the back of my mind. Many of you have been asking me about that, and I think that sets the stage very well for the uncertainty that we face wherever you are in the world today. Just a few thoughts about what we're going to talk about over the next hour. We're here to talk, now that we've examined growth from all aspects, the good, the bad, the ugly, the absent in some cases, about the global outlook for the year to come. As we all know today, many of you are company executives. You know better than I do that today's low growth environment has had a few very unintended, unpleasant consequences that both the developed world and the developing world are having to cope with these days. Low commodity prices are hurting emerging markets. The low oil price is undermining inflation targets in many places in the world. And central banks have had to come up with a whole mix of, in often cases, loose and negative monetary policy that people are getting worried might make them irrelevant. It might have some harmful, unintended consequences further down the line. And all the while, China's economy is slowing down. And there's one thing that I haven't mentioned in this as well. It is the environment, because the big question that has come up time and time again in all of these sessions here over the last 2 days has been, when indeed we do return to growth, how do we make sure that it is sustainable and inclusive growth? So on that note, I'm delighted to welcome our three esteemed panelists today. We have Kathy Mitsui here to my left, who is Chief Strategist for Global Sachs Japan. Kevin Liu from INSEAD, who's also a partner at the private equity firm Partners Group, which is a firm that has $43 billion of assets under management. And last but not least, Matthias Backenagel, who, now this is really interesting. Some of you may recognize Matthias. He's the president of the Global Footprint Network. And in case any of you didn't know, that means he's the man who's responsible for the guilt you feel every time you take a plane and somebody says, how big is your carbon footprint? Now, before we get to all of this, I'm delighted to say that speaking of the environment, technology, and industry, we have a little surprise for you. We have two more surprise panelists, and this is a hint. Well, you may have guessed it. We're talking about 36,000-kilometer journey right around the world from Abu Dhabi and back to Abu Dhabi, powered only by solar energy. I'd like to ask the audience to welcome live from Tulsa, Oklahoma, via Skype, as you can see there, Bertrand Piccard and André Borschberg, the two pilots of Solar Impulse 2. A round of applause. So, gentlemen, I understand that you've just finished your flight and you've arrived in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Congratulations, you're almost over halfway there. First of all, let me come to you, Bertrand Piccard. You may remember the audience here in St. Gallen because actually you attended the St. Gallen Symposium all the way back in 2004. And now your project has not only gotten off the ground, it's gotten off the ground and halfway around the world. How do you view the outlook from 30,000 feet?
When you fly at 30,000 feet with a solar-powered airplane, it's another world. It's the world of exploration, of pioneering. It's a world where you are outside of your comfort zone, which allows you to think in a better way, to act in a completely different way. You can invent new ways of thinking. In normal world, it's exactly the opposite. The normal world is prisoner of old ways of doing and thinking. We're prisoner of old sources of energy. We are prisoner of old, outdated and inefficient devices that consume too much energy, that produce too much CO2. So, you know, the world of exploration is the world we should promote and implement much more in the industry, in the politic, and of course in the education.
And Andre, what's so interesting about what both of you two gentlemen have managed to achieve here is that a lot of people said a few years ago when you started this project that Solar Impulse 2 would have been impossible. It would have been impossible to get the private sector interested in your project, which is so environmentally friendly. It would have been impossible to get private industry to help you, let alone partner up with you and give you technology that you needed to accomplish this. How did you manage to do that?
You're right to say that when we started 13 years ago, we were told by the aviation industry that they believed it was impossible. But you know, very often disruption comes from outside. And if you look at the automobile industry, it's a software guru which created a company which shows, in fact, the way forward and that everybody is following. So we were in the same situation. But what it meant for us, of course, was that we first had to have different technologies and maybe a different kind of organization, different kind of mindset. And I think both was very important. If you see the partners we have, they come from many different worlds. But in fact, they share the same goal, which is to make our society more energy efficient. And this airplane is a demonstration of energy efficiency. And this efficiency we can and we should develop everywhere. So the solution, the technical solutions we have on board of the airplane can find their place, are finding their place, will find their place on all the world that we live on the ground, for our homes, for our cars, for our appliances.
Now, just to explain to our audience whether or not they know, I'm sure many of them are familiar with this already, there's only one of you pilots in that aircraft at any one time. I know that at CNN, we've interviewed you many times. You've been on our shows talking about this as you've carried on with your mission. But I want to ask you the same question that we've asked you at CNN before for our audience. When it's just you, Bertrand or André, up there on your own with thousands of miles of ocean there below, you're looking down, what goes through your mind?
It goes through our mind that we are already in the future. It's, in a way, it is science fiction. You fly with an airplane that uses no fuel, that is powered only by the sun, which has an unlimited endurance. It's the only airplane of its kind. No other airplane can do that. And it's today. We're doing it today. And each time we fly, it can be André, it can be me, we're thinking, we have millions of people who are following this adventure because they are supporting this message about clean technologies. Clean technologies should replace the old polluting technologies. It's not only producing solar power. It's about shifting our society to a more electric and efficient society. And when we fly, we are like supported by all the people who want to do it. And we also feel all the resistance, the one who are afraid of changing their paradigms, afraid of changing their habits. So finally, you know, the future of the world has all the solutions, profitable and technological, to protect the environment, but we have not yet solved the psychological problem of all the people who want to stay into their zone of comfort and are afraid to change something, although it would be good also for them.
André, you undertook a five-day flight, I believe, from Hawaii to San Francisco. There must have been a lot going through your mind when it was just miles and miles of ocean behind, and you're thinking, wow, what if a cloud goes past and suddenly there's a problem with my plane and I have nowhere to land? What goes through your mind? How do you train your mind for that?
But you know, first of all, it's an extraordinary experience to know that, in fact, with this airplane, you can almost fly forever. So your relationship with time is completely different. I mean, you dissociate yourself with the pressure to arrive fast because you will run out of fuel. So that's a first very strong experience. But of course, we think about, you know, what could go wrong. And the best way to prepare for that is to prepare for the worst, which means, for example, ditching, which means to use the parachute. And in our life, and that's also my experience, you know, when I am facing the unknown, I try to imagine what could be the worst situation. And by understanding that I could cope with it, I can put it on the side and really focus on what's happening. And this was an enjoyment. I could be so present, so conscious about the 5 days I spent in this this aircraft, despite, of course, technical problems, despite things happening in a different way than what was planned, that it was a great moment up to the end. I arrived on the island at 8 to 10 p.m. at night and decided to fly up to 6 a.m. the following morning, enjoying the last 8 hours, knowing this was the last moment I was spending in this aircraft on this fantastic flight.
Andre, to the leaders of today and tomorrow that are in the audience here, something that might be interesting to hear from you is how you deal with the unexpected, because obviously a few times you had to shelve your plans and you couldn't take off because the weather conditions weren't favorable. And how do you keep your team motivated? As you're saying, this is a 13-year project where, again, many people said, oh, it's impossible, then maybe the technology, you know, you had to refine, the climatic conditions were difficult. How do you keep your team on track?
I think it's a mix of two things. On one side, try to empower everyone, to make him, in one way, the owner of his world, the owner of the responsibilities he has. But on the other side, it's important always to challenge him to maybe enlarge its known territory. And by doing both, in fact, you see that you expand the energy, in fact, of the person, you expand the energy of the team, and you can bring it to a very high level of performance. In fact, performance, you know, is more related to oneself. It's not so much how we compare to other people, it's how we expand our own territory to be able to bring more effect to the project and, of course, also to oneself.
Bertrand, you spent a lot of time dealing with the political world, and obviously Solar Impulse 2 highlights the achievements of COP21. This is part of your ambition here. You addressed the political community at that time live again in a similar manner to you are today with our audience. How have you felt the political rhetoric and business community rhetoric has changed when it comes to making sure that the growth we do get when we invest in it, manage to get it through, will actually be sustainable and not detrimental to the environment?
5 years ago, the solutions to fight climate change were not profitable. So although a lot of people were talking about doing something, it was not possible to make it happen. In COP21, for the first time, a lot of people understood, especially in the business community and industry community, that the future of industry is in the clean technologies. So what is interesting is to see that the industry is now pushing to have a carbon tax, to have legal framework that obliges to be cleaner and more efficient. But you have all the one who are afraid of it, and you have the political world, which is in the middle. And the political world sometimes is too much, I would say, influenced by the people who don't want to change. And the work we're trying to do with Solar Impulse, the work that is done by the NGOs, the work that is done by the United Nations, is to remind the politicians that their goal is not to protect the private interests and advantages of some few people, but to lead the way in the general and common interest of society. And this is extremely important, because if they really understand it, they will put the legal framework that will make it mandatory to replace the old polluting device by the new clean technologies, which are modern and which are profitable, and which create jobs, and make profits, and stimulate growth. And by the way, also protect the environment. And this is where we have to reconcile also the left wing and the right wing in the politic.
It's where we have to reconcile the NGOs who are completely involved in environmental protection and the one who are responsible for economical growth.
André, just one final question to you here, just bouncing off what Bertrand was saying before. Your project is really interesting because you've had two aircraft makers help you actually create the craft itself, but then you've had something like 78 other smaller companies get involved as well and offer their technology. That in turn has spun off all sorts of important technological advances that could be marketable from here.
Well, they are. They're already, I mean, just to give you a very simple example, the insulation we have on board of this airplane goes into refrigerators to make them more efficient. But you can even look at it at the broader scale. In fact, this airplane is a smart flying grid or a flying smart grid, depending on the way you want to describe it. I mean, something, for example, that ABB is doing, and it's a great opportunity for countries who do not have a full grid installed to get this decentralized energy production, to be able to store energy because the users may not need it at the same time, and to manage all this energy very efficiently. If we can do this in an airplane, I tell you we can do it on the ground.
If I ask you gentlemen each, Bertrand, starting with you.
It's a forum about education. It's a forum for students. So it's also very important for them to understand that whatever the political world or the industrial world thinks, when somebody is graduating from a university, he has the choice between remaining in the common path, in what is known, in what is the comfort zone, or the choice to be a pioneer and an explorer. And if you are a pioneer or an explorer, you need to fight against the dogmas. You need to fight against the common assumptions. You always need to try to identify things that are outside the world of the specialist, outside what people have thought for such a long time. And it's the only way to achieve the impossible. It can be in a big project, it can be in a small project, it can be for families, for personal development. Just imagine that the solutions found can still be found outside of everything that we already know.
Well, that's exactly.
This is where education should lead.
That's exactly what I was going to ask you. I was going to ask you for your advice for the next generation to come. Gentlemen, thank you very much for joining us live via Skype from Tulsa, Oklahoma. The two pilots there of Solar Impulse 2, Bertrand Piccard and also André Borschberg. Thank you and good luck with the rest of your journey. So, as we bid Bertrand and André goodbye, they're going to be heading off on their next leg of the journey. I understand they're heading off towards New York, and then they'll go round, further around the world, stop down here in Europe. Maybe growth will be forthcoming by the time they do, before they end up in Abu Dhabi. And this is an epic journey that they embarked upon last year. And now we're going to embark upon our epic conversation. So, let me start out by coming to you first, Matthias, because obviously we've been talking about the environment here. Your organization has done so much for making people think about the legacy that they leave behind on the environment. What did you make of what they had to say there?
It's amazing what's possible. We always say the planet is limited, but possibilities are not. And that's a testimony to what we can do and what we need to do. The amazing thing is, for example, for Switzerland, to just take one test case, which is a very densely populated country, that there are various studies now that show that it's not only technically possible to power Switzerland entirely with renewable energy. And not only that, for the national economy, it's a net gain. Tony Gunzinger calculates it at $30 billion a year in gains to the national economy. So both it's technologically possible, it's economically a gain. What we're lacking still is a bit the will. So it's a very exciting future, and I think we need these lighthouse projects to invite us and say, wow, let's get off our butts. Let's do it.
Yeah, and if we do and fly, hopefully, eventually, the future will be flying in an environmentally very friendly way. Kevin, let me come to you, because you're wearing two hats. On the one hand, you're also a China expert as an academic at INSEAD, but also you're invested in the private equity space. And I understand, let me just tackle the latter first. Your private equity fund, how much of your investments are you dedicating towards growth, but growth that is sustainable, like what they're talking about?
Sure, yeah. So as you mentioned, Nina, my firm manages about actually 50 billion of assets on behalf of the pension funds, insurance companies, sovereign wealth funds, and other institutional investors. So by definition, when you manage that volume of money, you have to be quite broad, right? So we don't necessarily have very targeted amount for solar, for example, but we certainly in our activities, we have made investment into assets like this. Let me say that growth is very important for my business, because this is private equity's long-term business, right? We actually don't necessarily worry about tomorrow, you know, when I wake up, when I open Bloomberg, what's happening on the stock price. What I worried about is whether the growth drivers for the global economy are there for the long run. And I actually believe part of that growth drivers is all this technological advance, all these environmental aspects. If you look at China, for example, you know, the country has grown for close to 40 years at first double digit and then very high single digit. But today, if you go to China, I think the mindset in China is now the quality of that growth. So actually sustainability and environmental aspects, to me, is another growth driver for China, not a problem. I don't think that's contradict with the ambition of Chinese to have a better life.
But then again, China is one of the world's biggest polluters. Is it doing enough? China is one of the world's biggest polluters. Is it doing enough to unhook its famous power plants from coal, from all of the fossil fuels? And how can the private sector, private equity firms like yourselves, actually help to try and break the cycle, as these two individuals were telling us before?
Yeah, I think one point relevant to that I would point out is for countries like China, on topics like this, they actually have a very massive late mover advantage, in the sense that because they come late, they could go straight to whatever is the frontier of the technology. That, for us as an investor, we pay a lot of attention to that. If you look at high-speed railway, for example, in China, you know, they could go straight, rather than if you go to the United States, you really have to worry about that. What do you do with the Amtrak first before you think about what else you can do, right? So I think that late mover advantage for many developing countries like China would allow them to be actually more aggressive in taking advantage of those advances we've seen in technology, and that would drive the economy, that would improve the quality of the growth.
Kathy, many people often think about sustainable growth as something that you think of after you've managed to achieve growth in the first place. And that's a traditional view. Obviously, admittedly, that's changing. And when I talk about growth, we're here to talk about the global outlook, which is implicit that it would be over the next 12 months, because in 12 months' time, hopefully, we will be here for another St. Gallen symposium. But it's the time horizon that's important in both of these arguments. What does Goldman Sachs expect the global economy to be doing over the next couple of years?
Absolutely. So, you know, clearly, as we've heard in many of the sessions throughout the last couple of days, the world is growing, but very sluggishly, right? If you look at the developed markets, whether it be the US, here in Europe, where I live in Japan, growth is running around or below potential, and that's why central banks are having such a difficult time achieving their so-called inflation targets. Emerging markets are a bit of a mixed bag. On the one hand, you have China that's clearly transitioning its economy from a fixed investment, export-driven growth structure to a more domestic demand-driven one. So should we be surprised that China is slowing? I don't think so. And then you've got the commodity producers, exporters that are, like you said, having a difficult time. On the other hand, you have other economies like India that's growing, in our estimation, close to 8% over the next couple of years. So it is a mixed bag, and I think that investors are having a difficult time sort of navigating all of these various modes of growth, particularly when central banks, for example, in the US, are on the verge of exiting or have already started the exit process from quantitative easing and zero interest rates, whereas here in Europe and where I live in Japan, they've embarked on negative interest rates. So what are you supposed to make of that? You know, it's extremely confusing and divergent in terms of the policy paths.
So where do you think it's going to go? Let's tackle those things individually, and let's come to low interest rates. In fact, Japan got the ball rolling on that really well and truly. One of the biggest major economies to put through negative interest rates. Do you view them as dangerous? Do you think that we're addicted to negative interest rates, addicted to loose monetary policy? And when I say we, is that the markets? Is that industry?
So it's a real dilemma for policymakers who, again, put out or establish very ambitious targets for prices when, in the reality, many of the factors that are depressing price levels in many of our economies don't really have to do with the supply of credit or the supply of money. They have to do with different issues, for example, demographics or the lack of deregulation. I've always viewed monetary policy, QE, all of this stuff as helpful band-aids, helpful to ease the pain from the wound, but obviously never really going to address the underlying cause of the disease. So clearly all of the economies that are very heavily relying on monetary policy really need to take a hard look at what are the structural causes of disinflation or deflation. I would argue there's some progress more than others, but that's clearly going to be a long work in progress.
Well, the reason why it's so interesting to ask for your view on this is because obviously Japan has been touted as the example that Europe is becoming these days. Do you buy that argument?
Ooh. There are obviously many similarities. I mean, Japan, clearly after its asset bubble burst in 1990, went through a very long and drawn out financial and banking crisis. I would argue that Japan played see no evil, hear no evil about their non-performing loan problem for a very long time. The problem, and maybe the advantage Japan had though, and maybe we can talk about China as well on this score, is that they, at the end of the day, had a very large current account surplus, very large private savings surpluses. In other words, they had enough money to buy time to kick that can, you know, sort of down the road. Japan has enormous debt to GDP, but it owns most of its debt, right? That's why rates have never blown out. So, yes, there are many, many similarities, but at the end of the day, the solution to these problems is not a magic wand, right? The solution to these problems is trying to directly address the underlying causes of why is it low growth, why is there low demand, and trying to get us out of that.
Kevin, what do you make of the situation that we have here with negative interest rates, especially from an academics and PE point of view as well?
Sure, I completely agree with what Kathy just mentioned. I think in spite of the many dissimilarities between China and Japan in terms of the stage of development, in terms of the role of the government, obviously they're very, very different countries, but there are a couple of very striking similarities in the sense that I think both governments have already adopted those more short-term measures, those easier measures to try to reinvigorate the economy. I think in Japan, the central bank has gone as far as negative interest rates. In China, they have gone that far. But both suffer, I think, one problem, which is some of the longer structural problems are not being fully tackled, right? If you look at the case of China, you know, I think I go to Beijing very often, and on a monthly basis, I think a strong view, if you talk to the intellectuals and the policymakers, was that the best time for China to actually start to tackle those structural problems, try to start those reforms, would have been probably 7-8 years ago. When the economy was good, China was on a cleaner path to growth. If the government at that point, 2005, 2006, have started a more decisive way to really look at state-owned enterprises, look at this rebalancing of economy, China would be better positioned. But unfortunately, even for China, they have a 10-year leadership cycle. I think at that point, the government did not take some of the measures, which leave them today, which is the external environment is more difficult. I think the bullets from the government are fewer, but I still think they're trying to do a good job there.
What's really interesting is that before this panel, you and I were speaking offline, and you were saying, well, most people say that China's really hard to predict, but it's highly predictable. So if you think it's highly predictable, what is your prediction?
Yeah, I think I was making a slight exaggeration, but I would take that position. I think if you look at really long run of the Chinese economy, I personally think it's highly, highly predictable, because if you look at the growth drivers, right, in terms of urbanization, which I think Leslie mentioned in this morning's panel as well, you know, 500 million people are going to move cities into the cities in the next 15 years, and which means massive amount of demand for infrastructure, for housing, for other things, right? Or if you look at the other aspects of the economy, the fundamental drivers are clearly there. So whether in the short term, whether it's 6 or 6.5 to me, doesn't really matter. For a long-term investor like us, it doesn't matter that much. Right, so I think that's a key point. And even for the controversial issue like RMB, I think since last summer everybody was shocked. You know, why did China do this? You know, they moved the exchange rate without telling anybody. The market panicked. But if you go back 10 years, read Governor Zhou's policy speech 10 years ago on RMB. He laid out a very clear path, what he plans to, right? 10 years ago, he said, there's going to be a gradual appreciation of RMB, and at some point, that's number one, which is exactly what happened over the last 10 years. And number two, at some point, the PBOC is going to shift that pegging to dollars to a basket of currency. It's extremely predictable on those large issues in the long run.
Matthias, you're not nodding, are you? Do you not necessarily agree with that? Tell me about what you think about China and its transition, because obviously it has a huge impact on commodity, fossil fuels, all of the types of stuff that you study on a daily basis.
China is amazing, and I'm not a China specialist. We have some projects in China. They have embraced the concept of eco-civilization, and I'm quite impressed by that because they recognize the resource dependence of China. They're now at the stage, there's actually one thing which is interesting, just academically. It's the country that most embraces academically what we are doing. We don't get any kind of pushback. Mm. They even show the graphs of China in public. In parks, we found them just by accident walking there. There was like an ecological exhibition, and they show the graph of China having used about one China by 1970. By now, they use over two Chinas. The resource demand of China is twice as big as what China can renew themselves. People think they are like large net exporters. Actually, it's not that clear. I think they may even be net importers of resources right now. The resource demand of China has doubled nearly in the last 10 years. The CO2 emission per person in China is higher per capita than in Switzerland. And so they buy themselves peace through rapid expansion, which is highly exciting at the time. But the question is, can they maintain buying that peace through that massive material expansion for a long time? And I would say now, as China is so heavily integrated in the global economy, if China sneezes, we all will get a cold. So it's not as kind of steady anymore as we hope. I can see these predictions. I mean, so I think there is this, I think, a more clear vision of where they're going. There's more alignment. But I think we also need to understand that the central government may not be as powerful as we think. A lot of the gains that they got was by devolution, to give more power to the provinces, which have more power over economic development. So there is tension between where the provinces want to go and also where the central government wants to go. And also, there are now more billionaires in China than there are in the United States. There's incredible creativity. They are 40%, that's what I read in The Economist, 40% of the artists that make more than $1 million a year are Chinese. That's incredible creativity. Creativity is also the origin of conflict. And there's now financial, private capital to maintain this conflict. So I think they recognize these challenges and think they're much better prepared, much open to these challenges than many other governments. But still, I think just to extrapolate the past into the future is too simple, even for China.
And how do you think that reality will affect the rest of the world, though? Because we've seen how we've seen how it's affected the markets in January, in March. But how do you think it'll affect the emerging world and also the developed world here in Europe?
I think one question I would have liked to see more in this symposium around growth is not whether we want growth. We all want growth. I want growth. It makes distributional conflicts much easier to resolve. So that's not the question. But the question is, how will our economies be able to cope if they cannot get the growth they need? We already have areas in the world where there's like negative growth potential. If that cannot be sustained, so much of our wealth creation, our wealth that we see, is dependent on the expectations about the future. So there's vast balance sheets that could get lost if we cannot maintain that. So the sneezing could be quite, I mean, I'm not sure we have the antibiotics for everybody.
Well, you've already actually seen some of the sneezing or the catching the cold in the region, right? There's so many of Asia's regional economies. Or look at here in Europe, German companies as well, very, very dependent on a thriving and healthy China. Well, once China starts to slow, it's not in recession, but if it goes from 8 to 10% to 6 to 8%, that means a big delta shift in the demand and revenues of a lot of companies that are very, very dependent on that one economy. So we've already seen evidence of how bad it could get.
Absolutely, and then when the economy falls, that has knock-on effects for monetary policy, which would affect the value of the euro as well. Now, I'm conscious that we've only covered a very small amount of what the topic is about. So I'm going to open things up to the audience to ask you to cover the rest of what you want to cover, so that to give you enough time to really tackle the main issues. As we get microphones towards you, I might ask, and I know other panelists and moderators have asked this before, if you could raise the light so I could see. Thank you very much. Right, we have a couple of questions. You, sir. Usual house rules, please be brief in your questions and mention who you are.
My name is Vishwa, I'm from Singapore. I think over the past few days, what I've sensed is the primary problem is the dominant logic. It's not whether GDP growth is more important or less important. I think we are stuck in a dominant logic that is based on an industrial mode of thinking, which is in turn predicated on a linear cause-effect. But I think the solution lies in shifting to an agricultural mode of thinking, which is focused on an ecosystem where a huge tree trunk is not more important than the bacteria. We all have to be interdependent. So this whole binary thinking process, which is what we are stuck in, the dominant logic, needs to be suspended. Otherwise, nothing is going to change. And we have been stuck with this binary logic, this dominant logic, for too long. And unless we are prepared to shift that logic, whatever we have spent in the past 3 days talking about is going to come to naught. The question is whether we have the will to shift away and start thinking about alternative forms of logic and not insist that there's only place for one logic.
Now, let me put that question. I'm going to put that question to you first of all, Kevin, as a member of the private equity community, because this is something that goes around my mind all the time. When we talk about GDP growth, especially in the UK where I come from, City of London, people think, oh, money. We're going to make money out of this. Wealth creation. Is that really the objective here? Because obviously that's what your clients who invest in your fund will be asking for.
Yeah, clearly, right? Our investors put their money with us to get that commercial return, and this is what we deliver. And in the broadest, I don't see a conflict at all. I think in terms of the growth, there's a lot of debate today. I only arrived last night, I only listened in today. I think this whole debate about whether growth is the only dimension or the other dimension, I don't see any conflict. Again, in the case of China, I don't think you go to Beijing, there is that binary say you have to either do this or that at all, right? The other thing, I think using the word dominant logic, is that if you look at countries like China, exactly because they do not have an ideological baggage, you know, they do not have that, right? So what China has is that adaptability, right? If you listen to Premier Li talk about his policy, even though he has a very clear vision in where the country is taken to, but in the short term, he said, you know, this is like playing chess. Sometimes you move forward, sometimes backwards, sometimes left, sometimes right. It doesn't have to be a linear extrapolation of what they do in the short term on a tactical basis. But in the long run, I think you want China. When I was with the World Bank, we spent a lot of time a few years ago with the government on this report called China 2030, right, which is exactly to lay out that vision. You know, by 2030, China will be a high-income country. How does it get there? Will take adaptability, will take experiments. I think Matthias talked about the central provincial government. I think it's a bit of a misunderstanding on the outside, think they have different agenda. The way I see it is that the central government, provincial government sort of dynamics is exactly that there is a long-term vision, but the central government allows the provinces to try. And once it works, let's expand. If it doesn't work, let's stop it.
Matthias, you wanted to make a point on this.
What I love particularly about your question is the agricultural metaphor. Because ultimately, I think the biggest farm we have is our planet. And when you think like a farmer as an invitation, and perhaps that's my Swiss roots, you know, farm is about what's important about the farm is to maintain its ability to thrive. So I think when we talk about growth, we are too much stuck in just thinking about income. While actually we should think about wealth, our nation's wealth, our social wealth, our ability to generate income in the future. So I think the mistake we make is to focus too much on income generation and not being able to distinguish between liquidation and generation. So it's like we say, hooray, we produced 100 Swiss francs, and we don't measure or forget whether our wealth may have gone down 200 Swiss francs, and we get poorer. So I think that's kind of, so countries like China, they think more about the entire concept, their ability to generate, to produce. But I think our focus, and in most countries of the world, so single-handedly on an attempt to measure income, but not fully measuring, and so not understanding how full the bathtub really is, we make very poor decisions and often mistake income with liquidation. It's like taking money out of the ATM machine and say, hooray, I earned money. It's an absolute flaw.
Let's take another question from the audience. There's a lady there with your hand up. Keep your hand up and we can get a microphone to you. Thanks.
Hi. My name is Debo Priya and I'm studying my master's in economics in Geneva. Well, I have a very basic question. The thing is, all over the symposium that I've been attending over the last 3 days, there has been a lot of discussion over what the broad solutions to the problems will be. But I want a very specific answer. Like, for example, you mentioned that using mere monetary policy to solve issues is not a long-term solution. So can you tell us exactly what are these fiscal policies that are required to get rid of the structural problems, and what exactly are these structural problems that exist? Because if it had been so easy to get rid of these problems, I am sure these policies would have been implemented already. And as Mr. Liu explained, that there needs to be some experimentation. You just mentioned that we need to go through experimentation to get China to what you expect or predict China will be 6 years hence. So what are those experiments and what will those results be?
Yeah, let's ask Kathy the first part of your question.
So when I said structural solutions or solutions of structural problems, I didn't necessarily mean fiscal measures, because fiscal measures imply taking government money, spending it on roads and bridges, and Japan is very, very good at that. But what they haven't done, for example, in the past, is deal with some of the underlying problems, for example, demographics. We all know Japan is a rapidly aging society. Do you know that there are more pets than children under the age of 15 in our country? That's how dire it is. But we've known this, we've had the projections thrown in our face, but nothing has been done. So only in the last 3 years, Prime Minister Abe, all of a sudden, out of the blue, to many surprise, he starts to talk about womenomics. He starts to talk about half the population that might not be fully utilized, right, in Japan's economy. Did you know that today Japan's female labor participation rate, 66%, it was 56% only a few years ago, is now higher than that of the United States of America at 64%. Now, that's not just all because of political, you know, mantra. There's been a very tight job market. The economy has been growing. But I think these are the sorts of things that societies really need to address. What are those root causes? While I'm on the women thing for a moment, I think in a lot of developing countries, I'm very involved in initiatives on educating women, right? In all of these countries, especially in South Asia, I think there's a humongous opportunity that if we can really disperse and broaden the opportunity set for women in many countries, and let's include the Middle East in this equation, that to me is a very specific targeted, I call it, this is the silver bullet that will help a lot of the world's ills.
Yeah, and on China.
I think that's a very good question. If not monetary, then what, right? But I think, let me give you two specific answers. One is that I think it really differs from country to country. I think every country's fundamental economic challenges are different. In China, I think the bigger problems are how do you deal with the state-owned economy, right? It's very big, it's very large, especially today when you have the overcapacity of those industrial sort of capacities. What do? Right? You cannot just say you let them go bankrupt in one day, because you have massive unemployment, which is why what has been holding the government back from making those reforms. The second, I can give you something even more specific. If you look at China, urbanization, right? What they are. They are trying to see whether it works. You know, many of you probably know China has this system called Hukou, which is a resident permit, which essentially does not allow rural residents to freely move to the city and to enjoy that. But China is trying very hard to try different ways. So, for example, in one city called Chongqing, one of the largest cities there, they actually have experimented just giving out that permit to rural residents, allow them, several million of them, 3-4 million of them, of a city of about 33 million people, let those rural areas come to the city and see how it works, right? So on those on important issues like urbanization, I think China definitely is continuing the tradition from Deng Xiaoping, is to trial and error and then see how it works. And I would only add, urbanization is hugely important for China. If you look at the history of the Chinese civilization of the last 5,000 years, it's probably 24, 25 different dynasties. Every one of those dynasties disappeared because they couldn't handle the dynamics between cities and rural areas. So I think this government, is nominally communist, definitely are insistent to try to find a way to sort of solve that that problem at the same time that could bring a lot of economic opportunities. So the trial and errors are definitely going on in China in many, many areas such as this.
Kathy, can I also just ask, just before we come to you, Matthias, let's circle away from Asia for a second and just talk about generally other economies around the world, Europe, where we are here. We keep hearing time and time again from various institutions like the IMF that, look, monetary policy has to be backed up with fiscal policy, with spending. Do you think that we're actually going to see the spending that we need to get the economy growing in places like this?
I believe that you will get more fiscal stimulus precisely because there's so much noise about the limits of central banks, ammunition pools. Japan is going to be hosting, as you know, the G7 summit in a few weeks' time, and I believe the communique that will come out of that summit is going to be something along the lines of all of us need to contribute more to global growth by turning on the fiscal spigot. Now, of course, country by country, that's going to differ in terms of the composition of that fiscal spending. But I do believe, to answer your question, we will get more rather than less. But again, the question is that only buying more time? While, if structural changes aren't happening at the same time, then that growth is obviously not going to be sustainable. So I put both monetary and fiscal stimuli in the same sort of, it's pro-cyclical, they're very nice, bandages, but are they really addressing the underlying cause of the wound?
Matthias, we're going to take another question soon, but just briefly, if you want to add to that.
So looking at solutions, and I'm not a monetary specialist, short-term architect, but from a public policy perspective, I think the axis between austerity and stimulus is really the wrong way of thinking about it. What we need to think about is rather, with every dollar we spend in public money, are we creating wealth or not? Are we net creating, or are we just digging holes and filling them again to keep people employed, but not being better off in order to generate income in the future? So that's the question, not stimulus versus austerity, but are we generating wealth?
And what's the answer to that question? Is it innovation?
And we're not doing that. So an example from Switzerland.
What do you think the answer is, though?
Pardon?
What do you think the answer to that question is? Innovation?
For every dollar we spend, whether it's through austerity or stimulus packages, we have to make sure it generates net wealth. Otherwise, we're going backwards. In Switzerland, for example, the population had the wisdom to invest in a stranded asset. It's called the Gotthard Tunnel. It's a tunnel that will be built and will be opened when Switzerland agreed to have much less CO2 emissions. So we invest billions of dollars in making us more fossil fuel dependent. And we can afford it as Swiss because we're rich, we can afford to make mistakes. But from a public policy perspective, we are losing well-earned collective money in a project that doesn't pay off. So that's the mistake. So we have to focus on wealth creation. That's the point.
Right, let's take another question. We've got a couple here. So let's start out with the lady with the glasses with her hand up.
Thank you very much. When it comes to climate change and environmental issues, we have from 5 to 10 years to reduce drastically emissions if we want to keep the Paris targets. And what does that mean? It means that we have to phase out fossil fuels, basically. It means that we have to leave at least 80% of known resources in the ground. And that's basically the scientific truth of it. And I was wondering, actually, to which extent this reality is reflected in the investment that you make for your clients. So are you actually disinvesting from fossil fuels? Because it's probably what we need.
Kevin, we talked before about...
I'll give you two answers. One is for my firm, one is my personal view. I think my firm certainly has been very much focusing on the renewable part of the spectrum. So we have a large solar platform in Japan, we have invested in Thailand, wind power, we're looking at other Asian countries on the renewable side. My personal view, though, is a bit more nuanced. I think if you, I used to deal with many sort of not only emerging but frontier countries. Like, you know, if you look at Asia, look at Myanmar, look at Mongolia. You know, I don't know whether you have been to Ulaanbaatar. I was there many times. If you go there in the winter, you will see people are burning everything they have in order to get heat. So for them, I think to move to cleaner coal is a great improvement. I don't think we can take an ideologically purist view to go to them to talk about wind power or whatever. Obviously, should do that, but I don't think in some situations you could completely phase out those traditional power. That's my personal.
And Matthias, this is the irony of what you hear time and time again. We had Cesar Purissima here on the stage this time yesterday, and his country on the one hand often says, well, look, we have trouble reining in the amount of CO2 that we emit, but we are directly impacted by environmental change with things like Tacloban, and it affects their people on a day-to-day basis. So very often the developing world is a contributor, but it also suffers the most.
I think the question asked by our colleague is a very good one. And we were asked for the panel to think about the next 12 months, and what I was most surprised in the last 12 months are two events. One was on December 15th, I think it was the December 15th, when the Paris Treaty was signed. 190 countries, including Russia, Saudi Arabia, Iran, Venezuela, were part of the deal of saying, yeah, that's the Paris Agreement. Let's limit to absolutely maximum 2 degrees, maybe 1.5. And what I was most shocked about I was surprised, and I think if you didn't pay attention, you were surprised. But if you paid attention, you were surprised. What I'm most surprised is that the financial markets barely budged. If there's a sudden surprise of such an agreement, and then you don't see a shift in the portfolio, that those who are more invested in fossil fuel versus those who are less, there's like a shift in the market. Either the market knows already everything about the future, or they're absolutely clueless. But there's no middle ground. It's one of the two. You have to pick. Then the same event repeated. Earth Day, 22nd of April, 170 of the countries came back and actually signed, and Kerry with his granddaughter. I was surprised so many came back, because I thought it was only because of the terrorist attack in Paris that people suddenly were warm-hearted and said, we have to do something for the world. They came back, and they signed, and the markets didn't budge. So it's interesting, I think, this kind of big gap between the financial worldview of the same planet and the scientific worldview. And it's like two different planets, but it's the same.
That's a very good point. And the one thing that could derail a lot of these arguments and your question there is the oil price. And I want to ask you, Kathy, obviously with the low oil price today, that is also likely to sap demand for sustainable, environmentally friendly growth, isn't it? And Japan in particular has its own issues with energy policy Fukushima.
That's right. And for your question, in a Japan context, obviously, if we did not have that terrible disaster of March 2011, one-third of Japan's power generation would still be nuclear dependent. Unfortunately now, given that disaster, given that Japan is, oh my God, did we not know this? It's an earthquake, fault-ridden country. Maybe we shouldn't have so many nuclear plants. The public outcry against nuclear power is so, so loud. And we do not have enough, maybe some solar investment, but clearly not enough investment in renewables to make up for the difference, right? So Japan's in a bind. Japan's in a dilemma of how do they meet these very ambitious targets with a society that is saying, no, no more nuclear, right? It's a big challenge. So they're going to have to make up for the shortfall, unfortunately, with cleaner coal or, you know, LNG, shale, or some alternative uses. But it is going to be, you know, quite a challenge, I think, for certain companies like countries like Japan.
Let's take another question from the audience. You've only got a couple of minutes left. So there's two gentlemen with their hands up, three, actually. Let's see if we can take you, sir, on the left first. And I'm afraid I'm going to have to ask you, if possible, if you can just limit your questions to one member of the panel.
Hello, my name is Zhu Jun. I'm from China. I'm also a student from the University of St. Gallen. I have a specific question for Kevin, if I may. So I would like to bring in the dimension of political discussion. Actually, I have more faith now in the United States, given the predictability of the political system. For example, if Mr. Donald Trump won the presidency, we can expect the opposite. But for China, it's more difficult to predict now, because now the markets react not so favorably according to the government's wishes. So it was, for me, my observation is a different case. So in the past, the markets will follow strictly the directions of the government's orders. But now, because the governments encourage more creativity, encourage more innovation, even encourage more openness and interconnectedness, which surely makes the Chinese economy more unpredictable. So my question to Kevin is that as a PE expert, how would you really protect your interest in China? And how really, what kind of observation you have regarding the interactions between the politics and economics? Thank you.
Okay, maybe quickly, as the investor, I think what we look for is the synchronization between long-term conviction and short-term conviction, right? So when only we are a very large platform, we have the luxury of being very selective on transactions. But I think we have the luxury to really be selective only when we are both have that conviction for the long term and in the short term, do we do the investment, and we don't do one way or the other. So just link back to also to your question on the politics, I agree. I think the predictability of how the market will react to policy directions is certainly less than before. Is that a good thing or a bad thing? I think it's a good thing, right? I think that means the government, the policymakers, have the confidence to sometimes allow the market to move at its own will rather than forcing the market to move to whatever direction the government wanted to move. Sometimes they tried, that didn't work. Last summer, they tried to move the stock market, that didn't work. They learned the lesson, right? And I do agree with you on one of the things you're hinting is that I think in the near term, you will see more volatility because of that divergence, right? I mean, China has been politically tightly controlled for many years. I think it will continue to be tightly controlled for another number of years while the economic side continue to get freer and freer. So I think there will be short-term volatility, but in terms of long-term conviction, I'm very confident as an investor to China.
Let's take another question. Could you please raise your hands? There's a gentleman with his hand over the back. Thanks.
I'm Dhruv Malik from India. I am a student of MBA in sustainability. Hi, I'm Dhruv from India. I'm a student of MBA in sustainability from IIM Lucknow. Back in 2000, we had a dot-com bubble. Then 8 years on, we had a housing bubble. And it's 8 years again. And now we're looking at major economies like US, where the debt to GDP is more than 100%. So are we looking at a bailout bubble? And if that happens, like corporations can be bailed out by governments, but who will bail out the governments if there is a bubble?
Kathy, are we seeing another bubble brewing, whether it's US government finances, whether it's the markets that are, the S&P is up something like 200% since 2008. Do you think there's a bubble brewing in some of these places?
Well, there's certainly that view out there in markets. Some people would argue that China's credit expansion is a so-called bubble. There are many definitions, but you know, I think in terms of the next 12, 24 months, if you look at the so-called excesses in various economies around the world, certainly there are some potential hotspots that we need to monitor, like, you know, China credit, maybe the negative interest rates in some of our markets is going to lead to a big asset bubble, say, in real estate, you know, at some point. But I think the problem is not so much worrying about asset inflation as it is about disinflation and deflation is probably the bigger problem. And as you rightfully point out, with large government deficits, right? Deflation and large government deficits is not a good cocktail, right? So there definitely needs to be something done to address the situation of large fiscal imbalances. But I think in most economies right now, we don't see, for example, the huge excess amounts of household debt, which I think have toppled or punched or burst bubbles in the past. We do have large pools of private savings. The problem is those private savings are doing nothing, right? They're staying in the bank or they're staying under the pillow and they're not being deployed because of an overriding lack of confidence. So I think what needs to be done is people need to dream about solar-powered airplanes, about sustainable growth, about innovation. Give young people, you know, that panel about robots, you know, was very, very, for me, depressing. You know, all of our jobs are going to be gone. Well, you know, surely there will be some, you know, opportunities that come out of these challenges. But people need to think that tomorrow is going to be better than today. And I think with a little bit better confidence, hopefully that some of that doom and gloom and lack of deployment of some of this cash will hopefully over time fill in those fiscal holes.
Now, I'm aware that there are many other questions here in the room. I'm also aware that some people have to get on planes, including myself, to get back to London. So I'm afraid I'm going to have to wrap it up here because we've run out of time. I want to ask our panelists to just quickly give us their view, in a nutshell, before we leave, of where they think the global economy will be headed when we come here in 12 months' time, starting with you, Matthias.
I mean, a big theme that will determine a lot is the increasing internal-looking populism. I live in California, and we look at the big spectacle out there called politics. So that will have a big influence on where we'll be in 12 months, whether we'll be more able to resolve these problems or stuck even more in the old trenches.
So populism is something you're number one worried about for this year. What about you, Kevin?
I think it's very, very hard to use a 12-month time frame, but I will say in the next 2 or 3 years, I don't know which bubble that is. I think there will be a crisis of some sort. I think that crisis.
Did you say where? Where?
I don't know, but I think there will be a regional global crisis. I think that crisis will be more difficult to untangle than before because the world is getting, the whole connectivity is only getting stronger. So when you have a problem, it's easier for the contagion to happen rather than you can shut your door. Like in Asian crisis, China shut its door, then it was barely affected. I do not particularly worry about China. Let's put it that way.
So you're overall worried about a bubble, but further down the line, spoken like a true private equity man over a broad time horizon, but you're not worried about China. And Kathy, where do you think the world will be in 12 months' time?
12 months' time, I think the world will still be standing, and we'll all be back here. But I do worry about geopolitics and isolationism. Everybody turning insular, looking at their belly buttons, not worrying about, you know, what the walls going up, trade barriers going up, really means for global growth and sustainability. That's my number one concern.
I'd like to thank our guests here, Kathy Matsui from Goldman Sachs, also Kevin Liu from INSEAD and Partners Group, and Matthias Wagenegel. Thank you very much for joining us there from the Global Carbon Footprint Network.